This video is about linear programming. Let us look at the following liquid knapsack problem with more than a single constraint. We are given several different beverages. Each beverage has a value and a preparation time per liter. Furthermore, we have T hours to prepare for a party and have a fridge with storage capacity C. What is the maximal value that can be prepared in less than T hours and stored in the fridge of capacity C? Assume T is 10 hours and the fridge has a capacity of 100. We could pick the beverage with the highest value, which is the fancy cocktail. However, we can only create 20 liters of fancy cocktails in the time given and have plenty of room left in the fridge. The total value would be 440. On the other hand, we could try to produce the beverage with the highest value per preparation time ratio, which is the beer. We could create 200 liters of beers in the given time. However, we can only store 100 liters. Using this strategy, we can only produce 100 beers. So we do not create any beverages half of the time. This amounts to a total value of 300. This is even worse than producing only the most valuable beverage. In fact, the best solution produces beer and cocktails and achieves a total value of 566. Unfortunately, the greedy strategy did not lead us to the best solution in this setting. How could we find the optimal solution? Even though the greedy strategy does not work anymore, our problem still has some nice property. The objective and the constraints are linear functions of the quantity of each prepared beverage. For now, let us look at the case where we are only given two beverages, beer and cocktails. We can plot our problem in the 2D plane. Let the x-axis be the amount of beer in liters and the y-axis the amount of cocktails. Every point on the plane represents a possible assignment. However, most of them are not valid and violate one constraint. We can also plot our constraints on the plane. Each constraint can be represented as a single line. The points below the drawn lines fulfill both constraints. Moreover, all valid solutions form a polygon in the plane. But we still have to find the best solution within the polygon. Let us take a step back and try to express our problem a bit more formal. Let xi be the amount of liters we produce for beverage I. Recall that each beverage needs a time ti to prepare and has a value vi. This allows us to express the time and capacity constraints as inequalities. The sum of the liters we produce for each beverage must be less than the capacity of the fridge. Similarly, the sum of the liters of each beverage multiplied with its preparation time must be less than the available time. Moreover, we can also formulate our objective to maximize the total produced value this way. The total value is equal to the sum of the liters of each beverage multiplied with its value. We now have the variables. Constraints. An objective written down. We can also express them as an optimization problem with n variables and m inequalities. Where our goal is to find an x that maximizes a linear function f, our objective. We refer to this as a linear program or short LP. Note that the left and right side are equivalent and match up. Using a bit of linear algebra, we can simplify the notation a bit further. From now on, when we refer to a linear program, we will refer to the following shorthand notation. The vector x is our solution, the matrix A together with the vector B specify the constraints and the vector C defines the objective. Usually, we require the variables of x to be non-negative. We call this the canonical form. It uses only inequalities of the form less or equal. However, we can express other types of inequalities to fit the canonical form. One equality constraint can be replaced by adding a less or equal and a greater or equal constraint. Similarly, the greater or equal constraint can be replaced by a less or equal constraint by flipping the signs of the A and B. Furthermore, minimizing an objective with positive coefficient C is the same as maximizing the objectives using the same coefficients but negated. We can express even more complex objectives that do not look linear at first. Minimizing the absolute value can be expressed as minimizing a parameter T and constraining X to differ at most T from the origin. Let us look how this more general form can be viewed geometrically. We can represent a LP with n variables in the n-dimensional space. Each of the m linear inequalities defines a hyperplane in this n-dimensional space. The hyperplane divides the space into two areas that either violate or satisfy the inequality. If we take the set of points that satisfy all inequalities, we get the set of possible solutions. We call this the set of feasible points. More precisely, the set of feasible points forms a convex polytope that is bounded by the hyperplanes of the inequalities. You can think of a polytope as a generalization of the two-dimensional polygon. A set is called convex if for every two points in the set, the line segment joining them is also entirely included in the set. We can check that the set of feasible points of an LP is convex. To prove this, we take two feasible points x1 and x2. Each point P on the line between x1 and x2 can be represented with a parameter gamma, where gamma is between 0 and 1. Now we show that P is also a feasible point by proving that P times x is smaller or equal than B. We begin by plugging in the definition of P. Rearrange the terms the following way. Then, we can upper bound x1 and x2 using the definition of a feasible point. The terms then simplify to B. This shows that each point P on the line is also a feasible point. Therefore, the set of feasible points must be convex. We call a constraint tight. For a point x, if x lies on the hyperplane given by the constraint. For an LP with n variables, the feasible points that fulfill n linearly independent tight constraints are called the nodes of the polytope. Note that n is the number of variables, and as such also the dimension of the polytope. Similarly, the edges of the polytope are given if n-1 constraints are tight. If two nodes share an edge, they are neighbors. In order to solve an LP, we have to find the point in the polytope that maximizes the objective. However, our polytope can be unbounded, meaning it is infinitely large. In some cases, it is even possible to have an unbounded large solution, such as maximizing the absolute value with no upper constraint. On the other hand, if a polytope is finite, we call it bounded. If the polytope of the LP is bounded, then we are guaranteed that at least one of the nodes is an optimum of the LP. This allows us to focus on the corners of the polytope and we can ignore the feasible points that lie inside. We can fix a value y for the objective. The set of points that reach this value is given by the following hyperplane. We can decrease and increase the value of y. This shifts the hyperplane through the polytope. To find the optimum, we increase the value of y and slide the hyperplane through the feasible points. At some point we reach the boundary of the polytope, which has to happen at a node of the polytope. This node must be an optimum of the LP. We can use this fact to create an algorithm to solve the LP. This is generally known as the simplex algorithm. We start from a single node of the LP polytope and jump to a neighboring node with a better objective. We repeat this until we cannot improve the solution anymore. To jump to a new neighbor, we replace one of the n-tight constraints and replace it with another. While this algorithm performs well in practice, there are instances where the time complexity can be exponential in the size of the input. There exist other LP algorithms such as the interior point method which are provably fast, but more complex. The node returned by the simplex algorithm is a local optimum. It is at least as good as all its neighboring nodes. It is not that difficult to find a local optimum. However, for our LP we would like to find the best solution over all feasible points, the so-called global optimum. It turns out that for LPs every local optimum is also a global optimum. Why is this the case? Let X star be a local optimum returned by the simplex algorithm. Consider the hyperplane that goes through X star. On it, every point has the objective value F star. It divides the space into two halves. Either the objective is higher or lower than F star. Because X star is a local optimum, all neighbors of node X star must be on the lower side. Since the polytope is convex, in fact the whole polytope must be on the lower side of the hyperplane. Therefore, there can be no nodes on the other side of the hyperplane and X star is a global optimum. This is generally true for convex functions. Now we know how to solve an LP. We repeatedly improve our solution until we find the global optimum. But how can we find our initial node of the polytope? One possibility is to always choose zeros as the starting dimension. Unfortunately, this point does not necessarily lie inside the polytope, nor is it easy to find such a point with a heuristic. However, we can use a neat trick and use a helper LP to find an initial starting node for our main LP. This helper LP will use more variables and therefore lies in a much higher dimensional space than the original. Given the main LP, we construct the second auxiliary LP by introducing a new helper variable y. In the helper LP, we adjust each constraint by subtracting y from it. We can write down the LPs in the canonical form the following way. Note that we try to minimize the y variables in the auxiliary LP. Now we try to solve the helper LP. Because of the new variable y, we can construct a starting node of the polytope. We set all x to 0. This reduces our constraints to y and b only. We also set y to the maximum of 0 and minus b. Now every variable has at least one tight constraint. The xs are all tight with regard to this constraint. Moreover, each y variable is tight with one of the two constraints depending on the sign of b. Therefore, this constructed point is a valid node of the helper polytope. We can then solve the auxiliary LP using the simplex algorithm. If the original LP is feasible, then there exists a solution for the helper LP where all the y variables are set to 0. Recall that we try to minimize y as our objective. Therefore, if we find a solution where y is set to 0, the solution of the helper LP will be a feasible point for the original LP. Afterwards, we can call the simplex algorithm again on the original LP to solve it. This gives us the following two-phase simplex algorithm to solve LPs. Let us summarize what we have seen in this video. We started with the liquid version of the knapsack and have seen that we cannot solve it if the problem has multiple constraints. However, because the constraints and the objective were linear, we could write them down as linear inequalities. These linear inequalities form a convex polytope in an n-dimensional space. Furthermore, we derived a strategy to solve an LP using the simplex algorithm. We first find a starting node on the polytope. Then, we iteratively improve our solution by walking on the edges of the polytope. Finally, when we have found a local optimum, we have found the best solution because the polytope is convex. Oftentimes, the main obstacle to overcome is not to solve the LP itself, but to express a given problem in an appropriate way so it can be solved by linear programming. This makes LPs a very powerful and generic tool to solve problems. Thank you for watching this video.